Thank you. I speak from Czech Republic, and we did it together with Michal Kravčík, who is in Slovakia. We will speak about the problems we have in our country and how we understand it. There is drying of landscape, which we think we have to first understand. Now you see the sun, and you see our globe, and sun sends a lot of energy, 1400, 1300 watt per square meter, which goes through the atmosphere, and we are getting here about 1000 if there is a clear sky, and we are afraid of the radiative forcing, which is 1 to 3 watts per square meter caused by the greenhouse effect. If there is a clear day, then we are getting almost 1000 watt per square meter. If there is a cloudy, we have substantially less. Here we measured, for example, 200. So clouds regulate amount of incoming solar energy. And now we have a look how is it with the land cover. On the left-hand side, there is a drained field or pavement. On right-hand side, there is a cultural landscape with plants, water, ants, and so on. And we are getting up to 1000 watt per square meter. If sunshine comes, the dry land heats, temperature increases, air heats from the dry land, and hot air goes up. It is this red arrow. If the sunshine or solar energy goes to the landscape with the water and plants, most of the energy is used for evaporation of water, which we call evapotranspiration, and it is conserved, fixed in the water vapor. So the land is then cooler. Now, how is it with the evaporation of water? We see 1 liter of water. It's a water liquid. To evaporate it, you have to add 0.7 kilowatt hours, which is capacity of one auto battery, and you will get water vapor. But huge amount, 1,200 liters of water vapor is made from 1 liter of water liquid. There is a lot of energy here, this 0.7 kilowatt hours. And morning, there is a dew, and the water vapor condensates back the water droplets, and energy is released. So it's a buffering of the temperature differences between day and night, and it's a main cooling system. Here is a picture we did with the, now you can do it with drone. We did it with the airplane. There is a normal, our landscape. It's 1 kilometer distance. You see 100 meters here. Harvested meadow, water, forest, and here is the temperature map. You see that we can find here surface temperature. There is a sunshine, 26 degrees, 28 degrees in forest, but the asphalt has 49, harvested meadow 42. So what is the message? There are big differences in surface temperature depending on the land cover. Water cools because it evaporates. And the same is with the plants which are saturated with water. Here are some numbers. Evapotranspiration can consume hundreds of watt per square meter. Decomposition of organic matter, it will release tens of watt per square meter. Heat flux to the soil, 100 watts. Primary production, which is photosynthesis, not much, several watts per square meter. And here are the atmospheric effects like CO2, methane, and so on. They just contributes to the greenhouse effect with some watt per square meter. What is really most important to understand, what we do with the water and how is it with the evapotranspiration. Here is a picture we worked in Kenya, in Naivasha, right-hand up corner. It's a view. So you see sand, you see acacia forest, and here is the lake. Now surface temperature. The sand has 60 degrees. And we go now to acacia forest, which is here. and there is a 20 degrees. So here we have almost 60 degrees surface temperature, and here 20 degrees, because there is a water, and there is evaporation, and there is a cooling effect. And because we remove vegetation in a huge amount of surfaces, we have more and more such a dry land, which overheats, and hot air goes up, and we have less and less vegetation, which is stable, and which regulates the incoming solar energy to life processes and to evaporation. There is a whole science on the effect of forest, effect of rich vegetation on the water cycle. On the left-hand side, there is a scheme of the ocean and then continent with the forest or with the rich vegetation. It evaporates, then the water vapor condensates, there is a small rain, and the air pressure drops, and the humid air is sucked from ocean. If we remove forest, the land will be warmer and warmer, and ocean will suck water from the land, and we are drying out. I'm afraid this is what happens in old civilization, and we have to understand that we don't repeat this mistake. So drained landscape overheat and warm ascending air transports water vapor up in the atmosphere and sucks humidity from surroundings, wetland, forests, and so on. It's a mechanism of landscape drying. I have here two words, plant blindness. We are forgetting what plant and trees are doing with climate. And now there is a second part of the talk. It is, how is it in our countries and what we do? This is what we inherited. The quite drained landscape, chaotic system, many roads which drain water, different drastic drainage of large fields, or again the roads in slopes of forests. You see such a canalization of the water. You see concrete jungle in cities, and there are several projects in Slovakia how to keep water in the top of the catchment, just doing very simple thing. Just local people go and make such a small partitions, you see. Or also in cities, there are attempts to retain rainwater. It's a Košice, East Slovakia. There are then different schemes how to understand, so keep drawings, how to understand how to keep water, that we do it in clever way. We wrote the book Water for Recovery of Climate. It's already 12 years ago with our Slovak friends, and we met Daniel Hofrung, spoke before me, best regards. We made book or special issue of the International Journal of Water with Ariel Shalech, thank you, Ariel. And there was a nice governmental project on restoration and integrated river basin management program for the Slovak Republic 10 years ago, where the aim was to retain water, to make local clouds, because we are inland country, and to restore short water cycle. And Michal calculated how much water will be retained, what would be increase of employment, how much it would cost to retain 1 cubic meter of water, so €4, and how to use evaporation, infiltration, and so on. And during this project, you see there was 7,700 seasonal jobs. This is costs, €43 million. and about 10 million cubic meter of water retention in the upper part of the catchments. The implementation covers the jobs for people. Their works calculated how much water will be retained in each etap. And this is a Slovakia map. Here are High Tatra. And imagine that 488 communities were involved in this government program. The trick was that here is their capital city, that money went directly to the communities. And then we calculated how much CO2 will be sequestrated because you increase production of plants, how much sensible heat, which means real heat, is then hidden into the water vapor concerning one cubic meter retained water, how we decrease the temperature. And here are some examples again what people did. Local sources, local people. I think sometimes good fun. And now here are mountains, High Tatra, 2,500 meters the highest, and here is a lowland about 200. And we have a shift of rain from lowland to High Tatra. We think it is because here is warmer and warmer, water evaporates, but still is caught here in the High Tatra where it condensates. So we have places which are really dry, and we have places where we have the torrential rain, which causes local damage. Another important thing is canalization in the towns.
Jan, I'm sorry, yes. You have one more minute, okay?
Yes, I'm finishing. There is a tree, and one tree evaporates water, let's say 400 liters per day, it consumes, and then it consumes 280 kilowatt hours. So this is a cooling system, such a tree. I think that I've finished. I just wanted to show that we need vegetation. Vegetation makes climate for us. Thank you.